Hey everybody, today I am going to be reviewing Promising Young Woman. This film was written and directed by Emerald Fennell. Emerald, it turns out, is quite a prolific artist in the industry. She is an actress and she is also an author. She has worked in television as a writer, and this is her directorial debut as far as film is concerned. And this one is turning a few heads, raising some eyebrows for its rather bold point of view. This is a black comedy, a modern satire with a very bubblegum pop but urban outfitters type aesthetic with a lot of genre bending sensibilities. It's part thriller, it's part rom-com, it has a lot of that kind of late 70s, 80s aesthetic. There's a lot of different influences here, but one that I kept thinking about just in terms of the kind of faux artificiality, that kind of faded pastel girly look, it reminded me of Robert Altman's Three Women, as well as the kind of slow motion, dreamy, very bright neons that you might see in something like a Brian De Palma film. And this film is always on edge. It's very tense. It does have that kind of pastiche Tarantino kind of quality to it, where it's always shifting between all kinds of different tones throughout a scene so that it's always keeping you on your toes, and that tension is very palpable. This movie wants to have a sort of sugar-coated kind of Candyland type of exterior, but they always wants to be able to twist that into something that is very sardonic and unexpected. Pink and fluffy, and then suddenly sharp and acidic. Carey Mulligan plays the title role here as Cassie, and I think she's wonderful in this movie. I think this might be one of her better performances just because, you know, she's known for doing very serious, very dramatic work throughout her career, and it was nice to see her do something that was a little cheeky, maybe not take herself so seriously, but yet she still has that amazing kind of depth of drama to be believable. And I think because of that, she really does give this character a true soul, like her true fingerprints, if that makes any sense. And it's one of those casting decisions where if I had read the script, I never would have thought of Carey Mulligan for this part, and yet she works so well, and that's part of what I like so much about it. And I think, you know, she's somebody that you want to root for, despite the kind of things that she's doing in the movie. You, no matter what, you want her to find a sense of happiness. You just really want her to let go of that past and that toxicity that she associates with that past, because she continues here to sink further and further into this kind of deranged persona, this bloodthirsty villainess a la Beatrix Kiddo in Kill Bill. Like noise pop kind of peppered throughout this very colorful revenge fantasy. And Mulligan just has a very endearing charm. What I've always loved about her is she's really adorable. She's got a very cute kind of smirk, but it's the kind of smirk, it's like a natural smirk where, you know, if she's looking at you while you're talking, it's almost as if she knows something about you that you do not. And I think that's a great quality specifically for this character, because the character of Cassie is utterly elusive, utterly mysterious, and I think that that both works as a strength in the script, and then it also works kind of more as a detriment, but that's more as the film goes on, maybe closer to the third act, which I'll get to. But you're drawn to her. That smirk kind of reflects a lot of her intelligence, because she is the smartest person in the room. You know, she has figured out a lot of social behavior and she's capitalized on it. She can use all those mannerisms and things against people to get what she wants, to gain her power. She is a master hustler. And she's also a woman, you know, who's not in her early 20s anymore. She's a bit seasoned and maybe a bit jaded by life. Damaged, I would say. But even like in her body language, it sort of reflects somebody who's just over it. And I've always loved her voice, you know, especially when it's in its natural British accent, but that kind of low kind of voice, as if, you know, she just doesn't care. She has a sort of confidence in herself where she doesn't have to put on, you know, a performance to sort of be accepted. She's damaged, but yet there is something in her that is very lively, something like an energy that you are drawn to. And a sweetness, you know, with the blonde hair and the like the kind of floral sundresses that she wears with the tennis shoes. It's like an Urban Outfitters advertisement, or like a like an H&M, like environmental friendly fashion campaign. And I have to say, this movie does an excellent job of capturing the aesthetic, all those little details that represent a certain quality of American culture. It's reflecting a generation that, you know, in terms of our adult lives, we've been brought up on social media and social media influencers. So you see a lot in this movie of a bunch of like boho mumbo jumbo, I guess you could say, and it's all completely inauthentic. A hipster sort of point of view where they're fetishizing, you know, the vintage look, I guess you could say. And it's very much in the spirit of Sofia Coppola and all those Rococo embellishments that you might have seen in in like the late 1970s in terms of decor. And beyond Mulligan, the casting here is on point. There's some really, really good performances here, and the people, just in terms of their look, they are the spitting image of the stereotypes that they are trying to portray, which is very funny. But because it's done so well, you can find something to admire in it, you know, in this very kind of surfacey, artificial, very ironic style. A generation just, you know, concerned with things that don't matter. As a movie, this is a feminist fantasy, a feminist revenge tale. And I really don't like to use terms like political terms like that as it pertains to an artistic discussion. But with this movie, because that the politics of it is so integral to the film, you know, I kind of have to use that. It's just so part of the point. And I think this is a movie that above all really wants to be entertaining. It really wants to grab your attention, and it certainly succeeds at that. But it also wants to subvert your expectations in a way, so that maybe we can look at the discussion about feminism and the Me Too movement and all of that from a different point of view, at least new wave feminism as it exists. For me, a lot of the satirical aspects, just the little kind of cheeky moments and the details in the movie, to me are part of what is the greatest strength of this particular film. And the idea behind it, I really love. I really do. It had me in its grip for a while. I was very compelled by it and just excited by the energy of it and the bold point of view stylistically. And I had hoped that this would be an examination of modern feminism in a way that would truly kind of delve into it and explore a lot of the themes that is presenting in its thesis. And I think with the right script, because this one as it stands is very rough around the edges, but with a really, really great script, this movie could have been brilliant. But unfortunately, the film overall just falls short. It really falls apart in the third act especially, but it wasn't the kind of fall apart where I feel like really riled up and angry at the entire movie. Actually, it was one of those things where, like, overall, yes, I was disappointed, but not enough to let that kind of taint the way I felt about maybe the first half of the film. But I think the problem here is, you know, if you're going to try to touch on all these different ideas, as this movie is, you know, the idea about you know, assault in the workplace, again, modern feminism, new wave feminism, what is consensual sex, what is non-consensual sex, all that sort of stuff. It's very interesting stuff, and I really wanted to see them sort of subvert those expectations and really get people to think about it in a different way that they haven't been. But I think this film is just more interested in the cleverness of it, you know, and the aesthetic, which again works for the cheeky, very satirical nature of it, but yet it still leaves something to be desired for me emotionally. Because it's not really holding up a mirror to society to me, it's more holding up a mirror to a mirror of society, if that makes sense. And what I mean by that is, again, it's just very concerned with surfaces. And a lot of people are talking about how this movie is dark, and yes, it certainly is dark. It's got a lot of dark things and things that you don't see coming in it that can be rather shocking at times, but I wanted it to go further. I wanted it to get a lot darker and maybe expose some of the flaws, not only in males, but the flaws in women and their point of view through New Wave feminism. Their motivations behind it as it stands today compared to, say, back in the era of the suffragettes. Because suffragettes, you know, really, you know, they're fighting for freedoms. They're fighting for their voice and equality with men. But then it changes decades and decades later, a century later, to where now modern feminism is less about equality and more about a power dynamic. It's less equality between the sexes and more the future is female, asserting a kind of dominance over men and villainizing them as a collective. The idea of women feeling they need to expose something by using their bodies in a certain way, to me, is a very toxic thing. And the idea that a man is afraid to even wink at a woman on the street for fear of her coming after him and tarnishing his reputation, all of this is very disturbing and toxic for me, and I would have loved to see this film really explore that. Because that is what this character is really representing, the new wave feminist. It's the idea of a woman wanting to have her sexual freedoms, but also be given the permission to misbehave in the way men have had the reputation for throughout American culture. But she's also wanting to have the respect for doing so. It's like wanting your cake and eating it too. And wouldn't it be interesting if this movie explored some of the flaws in those motivations psychologically and in a female's mind? Because this is a subject that I've thought long and hard about. You know, what drives bitterness towards the males to this degree, of course, beyond the obvious. Cassie has such an ingrained hatred for men as a collective because of something that happened to her in her past. And because of that, she is trying to expose them in a way. She's using her sexuality to prove a point. She's actively looking to bring out darkness in people, bring out ugliness in a way that feels very, very cynical. And rather than having that respect for herself and that respect for women, quite frankly, and recognizing that she's part of the problem, part of what brings the tensions to escalate to this degree, what causes the divide between sexes, instead she becomes a feminist mockery, a one-dimensional version of that, refusing to broaden her perspective and her experience. She is a product of that aimless sort of millennial generation, that millennial perspective, and you know, you look at her life and she's given up on so many of her goals. She wanted to be a doctor, and apparently, from what's said throughout the film, she was very, very good at it. She's 30 years old, but she still lives at home with her parents, and she really doesn't have any sort of motivation other than, you know, to get her revenge. And I think she's denied herself true feminism, you know, the true chance to find the happiness within herself, to truly find that freedom and that confidence in a healthy way. And I want this movie to really get in there and not just talk about it for the sake of irony or controversy. You know, it definitely dresses the part, but is it truly the part? You have a lot of scenes here that touch on really good stuff. For instance, the scene with the dean, where they're talking about all this he said, she said sort of stuff, and what qualifies as an assault, a sexual assault lawsuit. What are the ethical and unethical grounds for that specifically, and how does that add to the complexity of the situation? There's another scene with Alfred Molina where you see kind of the result of that, the result of kind of male guilt as it relates to the law. And then of course Cassie's boyfriend gets involved in a way that is of course very inconvenient, that raises the stakes. And all that stuff was really good, but they felt more like just little bullet points that weren't really given the time to expand on. But each one kind of gives you a whiff of something, but then takes it right back. And I think those ideas could have really challenged the protagonist, because I think she needs to be challenged more in the film, force her to question her own motives and her own delusions. I think if you want to make a movie about women and about feminism, and you want to do it in a respectful way, I think you've got to make a movie that stretches them, that makes them fully dimensional rather than kind of compartmentalized versions of themselves. And with Cassie, you know, it's like we don't know much about her at all. You know, they allude to at times that, you know, she's had a troubled past, she's run away a few times. Her father hints that maybe she's had a little bit of mental instability, but I wanted to know a little bit more about that. What she's fighting for, Nina, the character, the person that she's trying to honor through all of these acts of vengeance, we know very little about that as well. All of these are just kind of big, kind of overarching, broad concepts that never ground us in what she's fighting for. So all of these just feel like these broad, overarching concepts that never really ground us in any sort of emotion in terms of what Cassie's fighting for and why. We need the why. And it's not like I need a bunch of like Nina and Cassie flashbacks or anything like that, but I wanted a little bit more to go off of, you know, so that it resonates more. There are a lot of elements of the story that could have been opened up, but they closed them, I think, unnecessarily. And I'm going to go into spoiler territory from now on, so just be forewarned about that. But, you know, I love this idea of the whole he said, she said sexual assault claim. But when you don't have any evidence to back it up, that's when things get really messy and really complicated. And I just think that would have been the really interesting thing to explore. But no, instead, Alison Brie, that, you know, the character that she plays in the film, she comes to Cassie in the end and says, oh, by the way, you know, the incident that you've been so upset about for all these years was actually recorded. They made a tape of it. And I don't like that. I liked the idea of this ambiguity that forced us to sort of think about things in a different way. But no, suddenly, you know, we're given the evidence here in a way that just feels like tying something up in a neat and tidy way. And as the film goes on from there, it really does start to reduce Cassie's point of view, you know, the protagonist's motivations, to this one-dimensional revenge tale. And the ending naturally reminds me of one of my favorite films of all time. It's directed by Takeshi Miike, and if you haven't seen it, please don't listen to this, because this is part of what's so good about it. But, you know, there's a very similar scene at the end of Promising Young Woman that is very similar to the ending of Audition. But I think the key difference here is in Audition, the female in that, we know so little about her, but little by little we're etching away at her. And by the time we get to this big climactic point, suddenly a lot is revealed about her, but not only about her, also just about the way she's perceived things throughout the entire movie and the way her intended has perceived things throughout the entire movie. And it completely shakes up the way we've been viewing the film, totally changes our expectations. So suddenly now, when, you know, this climax is happening, it's all the more tragic because we've been enlightened in such a way. Whereas with this film, we get to the climax, and instead of it being opened up in this way to really see the tragedy behind Cassie's motivations, it again closes itself off. We are never truly let into what makes her the way that she is. And so in the end, she's just kind of this crazy, obsessed psycho killer in a nurse uniform. And I just thought that was such a cheap blow to her character, and she had so much potential. She deserved better. And while I do like aspects of the ending, because it is dark and some of it is quite unexpected and weirdly funny, I also feel like they did a major disservice when it comes to tacking on the very lame ending in the last scene, where it was very like, don't worry guys, Cassie got the last laugh in the end. She got her justice and she came out on top, and it was just kind of like, felt lazy, felt empty, really, really did cheapen Cassie's overall story. And then you have some of the song choices in the final maybe 10 minutes of the movie where they're using like Rodgers and Hammerstein's Something Wonderful from The King and I. Tad on the nose in terms of the irony. I know you might think by doing so you're like real punk rock and shit, but no, it just means you're really not saying that much. You're hiding behind the attitude of it. Having said all of that, overall, I did enjoy the movie. I'm just being very tough on it because I see a lot of potential here. I tend to be tougher and delve into something when I really feel like it did have potential. But it's fun, you know, it's interesting, and I think it's really got something. This is just a little half-baked and certainly very rough around the edges, but I would love to see her improve because I do think she has it in her to make something really, really great, like a real kind of a cult movie. And as I've said, you know, even though there's a lot of glaring issues in this movie, and I was ultimately disappointed by a lot of it, especially towards the end of it, I didn't feel depleted after watching it. I felt invigorated by the cynicism of it. Again, the aesthetic of it and the point of view there, that detail. The humor just has something a little prickly about it, and I don't know, it was something very alluring for me. So yeah, I'm gonna recommend it even though I have a lot of issues with it. I do think it's a fun movie to watch, and I am really excited to see what she, again, brings to the table next. And that is my review. Thank you guys so much for watching. All of my Patreon supporters are over here. You guys are fantastic. Love you so much. If you're interested in art and supporting artists, I am an artist and I have a website where I sell commission portraits as well as prints of my work. So if you're interested in that, you can go there. The link is below. I've really enjoyed working with the fans and would love to do more of it. But beyond that, all of my social media is below. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.